Hello, Dr. Atkinson.
Hi, Robert, Dr. McChesney. I can see you as well.
Terrific.
Okay, Dr. For the attendees, we now have both of our speakers. Both of these people are being so generous in giving us their time. They're very high profile people. They're both very high profile people. Our guest speaker is Professor McChesney. Professor McChesney, I hope you will make time at the end of your talk to take a Q&A session from both Dr. Atkinson and from the audience. Are you willing to do that?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah. And you do know that you're being recorded both on audio and on video.
Fair enough.
Fair enough. We are now starting. Has everybody ordered yet?
Yes. Yes.
Excellent. Okay. The floor is yours, Professor McChesney.
Okay, the floor is mine. Great. I thought I'd just say a few words about the book that I wrote with John Nichols, which I'm here to talk about, this book. People Get Ready, The Fight Against the Jobless Economy and the Citizenless Democracy. The genesis of this book came from a speech that Eric Schmidt, the Google CEO, gave at Davos 2.5 years ago. Yeah, Davos, of course, being the meeting of the world's political and financial leaders in Switzerland, where they sort of get together to discuss the big issues facing humanity from their perspective. And Schmidt announced to the attendees at Davos in his address that Google, as well as several other firms in the high-tech area in the computer industry, was then working on a series of technologies that were in the verge of being broken through that would revolutionize labor practices in the economy and would eliminate tens of millions of traditional middle-class jobs from the economy, not to mention working-class jobs. And Schmidt said that, in his view, for the next 20 or 30 years, the issue of unemployment, massive unemployment, and everything that comes along with that would be the defining political issue in the world. And when we heard that speech, John and I, when we read the transcript, it got our attention. It seemed like that was a fairly striking thing to say for someone in Eric Schmidt's position to say, not someone known necessarily as an alarmist. And we were wondering, you know, should we take this seriously? Is Schmidt just blowing smoke, or is there something to these claims? And if there are, what were the political implications for the United States in particular, but I think by extension everywhere in the world, given the claims that he made? Now, we thought even before you looked at the idea that technology could reduce the number of jobs dramatically in the coming years, we already face a pretty bad job situation in the United States. Our economy has been stagnant for the last 7 or 8 years. In general, rates of economic growth have been in a downward trajectory since the middle of the 20th century. And the last 8 years have been quite bad. Today, we're looking at a capitalism that's more or less dead in the water with negative interest rates, something we last saw in the Great Depression, the order of the day. We have immense amounts, not only of unemployed people, but unemployed capital, capital that can't find a profitable investment. So it's just being uninvested. For young people today, and I think I'm looking at some of the pictures in the room, we have people like myself, I have two children in their 20s. For young people today, the economy is pretty much in a Great Depression compared to the world I came into in the 1970s. When I got out of college in 1977, I had no idea what I wanted to do with my life. And I was able to get a job at a lumber yard, walking off the street, and only by the fact that I was 200 pounds, the guy hired me. And I made an income at that job in 1977 that today, translated for inflation, would be roughly $80,000 a year. And I was happy to have the job, don't get me wrong, but I didn't think, well, I've got it made. Now it's like winning the Irish sweepstakes. Now I can sit back. I'm the luckiest guy on earth. I only stayed in the job for like 5 months till I found something better. But that was an option. That was something that my daughters and most of the children I teach, the young people I teach today at the University of Illinois, or I encounter in my talks, would kill to get that sort of income with employment in their 20s. It's simply that those options are just far fewer. So we see a world today in which, as we all know, inequality has grown dramatically, poverty is growing, youth labor market horrible, working conditions, pensions, all these things are struggling to stay afloat. The situation's bad to begin with. And then to this, we're going to add in now a technological revolution, which threatens to eliminate a lot of jobs, many of them good jobs. And if it doesn't eliminate every job, what it will certainly do is provide tremendous downward pressure on an already weak and fragile labor market, giving employers much more leverage to lower wages and lessen working conditions and benefits that much more. So if this automation revolution's for real, you know, we've got trouble in River City. I mean, that's basically what our premise was. Now, I've been trained as an economist, as an undergraduate, and read in the field for the last 40 years, and I think I'm inherently skeptical about claims that technology is going to, automation is going to eliminate all these jobs, as most economists have been. And I responded initially to the claims by Eric Schmidt with like, well, there's more to the story. This has never been the case. And so I read as much as I could on the subject in the business literature, engineering literature, even the economics literature that dealt with the subject, to see how realistic this was. And I found out after reviewing it that it was fairly realistic. The people who studied these processes the most were the ones who took it most seriously. The people who were most dismissive, when I looked at them, they were actually relying on theories they learned in grad school they said haven't changed. They hadn't really looked at the technology very closely, the labor practices, and they hadn't really looked at the weakness of the existing labor market especially closely either. I think, you know, some of the arguments that engineers are making, a lot of them, in fact, were that we could lose as much as 50% of existing jobs in the next 10 or 15 years. And at the same time, there was very little sense of what would come along to replace it. There weren't emerging new industries that were going to have massive amounts of employment that would go ahead and replace.
Could I ask you just to move just a hair back because we're overdriving? Thank you so much.
Sure. That there weren't a lot of industries that were going to emerge that were going to create millions and millions of jobs for those that replace. And then last summer, I read an essay by the former Gil Pratt, who'd been the head of the robotics and artificial intelligence program at DARPA, which is the Pentagon's high-tech research lab, which developed many if not a majority of the technological innovations connected to the digital revolution over the last 40 years. And since the early part of this century, for over 10 years, Gil Pratt was the head of their robotics special program. And after leaving DARPA last year, he wrote an essay for an academic journal, and he was describing some of the progress that's being made in robotics and artificial intelligence. And he said that they were in the verge of breakthroughs that were simply almost impossible to explain. They were so sweeping. And to give the analogy he used to try to explain to people what we're on the verge of was he said that the United States and the world technologically are on the verge of what he said, another Cambrian explosion. And I've got to confess, I didn't know what the Cambrian explosion was when he said it. I thought it was an Arnold Schwarzenegger movie or something like that. But thanks to Google and Wikipedia and the internet, I looked it up and studied it and discovered the Cambrian explosion refers to that period on Earth roughly 520 million years ago when life made an extraordinarily leap, huge leap in about 20, 25 million year period from very simple organisms to extraordinarily diverse and complex organisms and put us on the path to where we are today. And he said, this is what we're about to enter. We're about to enter a Cambrian explosion. And just like no one prior to the last Cambrian explosion could have had any idea what would happen, we're very much in that situation today. He did say what was interesting to me, that the one place for sure we know we'll see immediate effect will be in the economy because there will be so much money to be made by businesses that can successfully employ these technologies to reduce their labor costs and increase their productivity significantly. Now, another thing I knew from being the age of 63, which I am, is that I grew up in an era in the 1960s where I heard a lot of these same claims, that the automation and computers and robots were going to eliminate all the jobs. And for this book, I went back and I re-examined that period, and we have a big chunk of one of the chapters deals with that first great computer revolution era and the claims that it, too, would eliminate all the jobs. And it was a huge deal in the 1960s, as anyone who's, who could think back that far, especially the first half of the 1960s, will remember. And, of course, it didn't pan out, the argument that computers were going to replace all jobs, which was a widespread belief, and there were government studies of it in the 1960s, taken much more seriously than it is today at this point. And when we look at this, the claims made in the 1960s today, they seem laughable. Because computers were so pathetically weak by comparison. The idea that they could replace jobs, they could drive vehicles, that they could take over employment, the economy, seems preposterous in retrospect, based on what we know in the 1960s. But, you know, the economy, the computer, what's changed since then is that computer power has grown dramatically. It's grown radically. Yeah, I'm sure you're all familiar with the term Moore's law, that computer power will double every year or year and a half or 2 years, depending on whose version of Moore's law you want to apply.
Professor McChesney, please move back a little bit because you're overdriving these speakers. Thank you.
Okay. Moore's law is the idea that computer power doubles every year, year and a half or 2 years, depending on whose version of the theory you want to say. What's important about Moore's law is that at first, it's unremarkable. Something doubles every 2 years, and then doubles again 2 years after that, and doubles again 2 years after that. But, you know, as you raise the, as you double over a period of time, you start getting up into some really interesting numbers. It doesn't take long. When you get 2 to the 10th power, you're 10 periods of doubling, you're already at 1,000 times increase in power. That's a lot of power. 2 to the 20 periods gets you up to 1,000,000 times increase. So Moore's law, which is held fairly true, suggested that starting in the 1960s, we would expect computer power to really increase at orders of magnitude, extraordinary. And that's exactly what's happened. It gives some sense of how computer power has increased. If automobile speeds increased since 1971 at the same rate as computer power, the fastest car in the world today would travel at 1/10 the speed of light. 1/10 the speed of light. If skyscrapers grew since 1971, if their height increased at the same rate at which computer power increased, the tallest building in the world would reach halfway to the moon. So this is when you get computer power at this level is when you have things like driverless cars, self-driving vehicles, which really isn't a cutting-edge technology anymore. Now, that's a generation or two back, but it's now sort of getting public attention at this point, so I'm these, you know, off the drawing boards. And this is what I think Gil Pratt at DARPA was suggesting, is this is where we're going. We're about to enter a period which driverless cars will look like the horse and buggy in the very near future. It will have tremendous implications for employment. And our book argues that this raises really fundamental questions for society, core political questions about what sort of economy we have. Because right at the top, we can see this presents a really complex crisis, maybe an intractable one for a capitalist, profit-driven economic system. Very few people are needed to produce what is necessary to sustain life, an economy in which production is for profit. Here the problem is, who's going to invest if there's no consumer class of income to buy the products? And that's a problem we already have in our economy now. Well, what happens when there's much less of a working population with incomes to buy products and the ability to produce an immense amount of products? So we have this dilemma or paradox that with this wonderful technological revolution with immense potential, what could be our greatest moment, the ability to solve problems, ecological, social problems, as never before, could instead become our worst nightmare, creating inequality, poverty, divisiveness that could be utterly tragic and horrific. So our argument is that this is the central political issue of solving the technology, solving the economy, coming up with solutions. And in the book, we go into great detail. I'm not going to go much more into this. I'm just going to cut to a few other points, then I'll open it to discussion. In the book, we note that this is not a new idea. Our greatest economists, really going back to the beginning of capitalism, many of them understood that capitalism, as brilliant as they often found it, was not a system that was built for the long haul. It would reach the end of its tether. It played a very important historical role, but at a certain point in time, it would get to exactly this point. John Maynard Keynes, the great, probably the greatest economist of the 20th century, wrote about what he called technological unemployment in 1930, which is the first he coined the term, which referred to exactly the process we're talking about. And at the depths of the Great Depression in 1930, he wrote a very famous essay, which we liberally quote in the book, A Note to His Grandchildren, in which he argued that the problem of capitalism in the Great Depression was not that it wasn't efficient enough. The problem, he said, was it was too efficient, that it, with things of technology, it didn't need people as much, that it was able to produce more than it could consume. And he said this problem would eventually grow and become far more severe. And he anticipated that 100 years later, this small percentage of the population would be necessary to provide the labor to produce what we needed to give everyone a decent standard of living, a high standard of living. And that this would lead to a fundamental crisis in all societies, because we have, for the first time, the economic problem, the issue of material scarcity and providing the goods and services we need to reproduce ourselves, would no longer have to be the driving force of human existence. And in many respects, it would force us to go through a very troubling period of rethinking human nature, what it means to be a human being. It was going to be an existential moment, and truly in the deepest sense of that term, for our species. But he was optimistic once we got to the other side of that process. It could be an extraordinarily period, a great period, but it would be a difficult period at first. And I think there's a lot of insight that Keynes had in that essay and in his work on those issues. But that leads to the question that we're in that period. Where do we go through this period we're entering? And we view it as fundamentally a political issue that requires political solutions. We're going to have to rethink our economy, rethink how it works, rethink what our society is, how it's supposed to operate. And here we get to the guts of our book, which is that unfortunately right now, our governing system is not well suited to the job. And John and I wrote a book called Dollarocracy in 2013 on the rise of money in politics and the corruption of our governing system. And we drew a lot on that when we wrote this section of the book, that our governing system today is in a very weak position to effectively solve these problems. It is corruption is the order of the day. It's dominated by the wealthy few, the special interests, and they get policies that serve their interests. And regardless of which party is in power, that has been the pattern. And if this remains the case, we would expect that instead of getting a solution, the problems will just continue to get worse and worse, and the bubble will finally burst. In the book, we talk a great deal about something called democratic infrastructure, which we argue are the institutions that make being a citizen possible. Just having the right to vote is far from making a country a democracy. You've got to have fair elections. You've got to have the ability to have parties participate, credible news media. You've got to have a whole variety of things that actually make in political equality, make it real, that we're increasingly losing in the United States. And in the book, we go through how this struggle for democratic infrastructure to make the country a more egalitarian political country, to share the power, has been at the heart of the American experience from 1776 to the present. It's been a defining battle that's taken on many approaches and many elements. And we argue that in the United States, from 1900 to around 1970, the United States became a vastly more democratic nation. A number of great victories were won. We expanded the franchise from a fairly small percentage of the population in the 19th century. And even in 1904, we have the figure in the book, I don't have it off the top of my head, Teddy Roosevelt won a landslide re-election for president of the United States in 1904. And I think he got something like 15% of the adult vote in the United States to win a landslide election in an era in which women couldn't vote, African Americans couldn't vote in the South, Native Americans couldn't vote generally most places. It was not an especially democratic nation at that time, but through a series of reform measures, we saw labor unions become more common, public education enhanced, higher education, public higher education become the best in the world, progressive income taxation, universal suffrage. By the late 1960s, early 1970s, it became a much more egalitarian, much more democratic nation. Political corruption became less. It became a better place. And we chronicle how that took place. And as we look at the period we're entering now, there are two central periods we think are of great importance for us to understand what we should be looking at in the future. The first one is the 1930s and early 1940s. The reason why that 1930s and early 1940s is so important is that the economic situation is the closest to our one today. The U.S. economy was in a Great Depression then. The world economy was in a Great Depression then. The private economy was largely dead in the water. And after a decade of recovery under FDR in the 1930s, when the government went back to balancing the budget in 1938, it threw the economy into a deep, deep recession again, which made people think maybe we're never going to get out of a depression or recession. And it was really the war spending that got us finally back on track to a full employment economy after a decade of stagnation. And during the 1930s, there were two great phenomena, ways to deal with depression and crisis that emerged. One of which was social democracy or the New Deal, or what we argue would be building out the democratic infrastructure, having the government work to enhance democracy, encourage investment, by limiting inequality, raising living standards, and working as moderate social democratic policies. The other approach that emerged foursquare in the 1930s and became dominant was fascism, which was sort of the elite reactionary way to have the state interject itself in the economy without threatening elite interests, without being a threat to the dominant interest in the economy. And elites understood that the government needed to play a huge role to get the economy working again, but they wanted to do it without threatening their control over the private economy, and the best solution for that was militarism. So fascism invariably brought with it a heavy dose of militarism in every country where it succeeded. And the fight between fascism and democracy, as it was framed at the time, became the way that Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president, wanted to frame and chose to frame the Second World War. It was a struggle between fascism and democracy. And fascism was a logical outgrowth of economies with massive unemployment in which people lost faith in their democratic system to be able to solve the problem. That's exactly how FDR saw it. And I think that's scarily not an unfair way to look at the world we're entering in and living in today, not just the United States, but clearly Europe and worldwide. And FDR in 1944 did something rather extraordinary. And it's worth, you can Google this, it's readily available. In his 1944 State of the Union address, he devoted the address to saying, what can we do? Then it was pretty clear that we were going to defeat the Axis powers. But what can we do to make sure we can eliminate fascism forever from the world as a scourge and never see it return?
Sorry about that.
Sorry. And what he did in his State of the Union address in 1944, in his speech to Congress, he said, what we need to do, he said, fascism is not something that is a peculiarity to Germans or Italians or Japanese people. It's not something due to some cultural characteristics they share. Fascism is a threat everywhere, including right here in the United States. There are millions of people, he says, Vice President Henry Wallace said, in the United States who are fascist, has fascist sympathizers. It's not something we can ignore. And FDR in his 1944 speech, we have to make sure fascism can never, ever sink roots here in the United States. And the only way we can do that is to guarantee that our democratic institutions, what we call infrastructure, are so strong that even if a great crisis comes along, people won't lose faith in the governing system. They'll trust that democracy can trump. And actually, that's the bad pun, I guess, at this point. Democracy can triumph and solve the problems better than a fascist government. And what he called for was that the U.S. Congress and people pass what he called the Second Bill of Rights into the Constitution or as legislation. And the second Bill of Rights would guarantee everyone a job and a living wage. Guarantee is a right to a job and a living wage, a right to health care, a right to housing, a right to education. This was, these were rights that were required to be met by the government. They weren't something that maybe you could get, but they were actually rights, just like the right to free speech, the right to worship whoever you wanted, the right to own a gun. These were guaranteed rights in the Constitution. And with these rights, he argued, then we would never have to worry. The battle against fascism would be largely won. Interestingly enough, he gained support for this. This was not a crazy radical idea at the time. He gained support for this from the 1940 Republican candidate for president, Wendell Willkie, who was a corporate CEO who has been was thinking of running for president in 1944. And Willkie endorsed the second Bill of Rights. And he made an interesting argument that labor unions were something that were absolutely mandatory for a democratic society. They were absolutely necessary, he argued, to prevent fascism. Societies without labor unions are far more susceptible to fascism than societies with healthy, vibrant labor movement representing workers. Now, the second Bill of Rights obviously didn't get anywhere. Wilkie died in 1944. FDR died shortly thereafter. And by that time, it failed. But, you know, it's interesting. One little smidgen of the second Bill of Rights did get passed by Congress. It was maybe 1% of what FDR wanted. And that was the GI Bill, which was considered one of the great legislative accomplishments of the 20th century, to give some sense of what was done, what his vision was for America. The other way that the second Bill of Rights persevered and survived, which is interesting, is that when the United States occupied Germany and Japan, in both countries, it helped rewrite the constitutions, or rewrite new constitutions for the post-fascist Germany and post-fascist Japan. And in Japan, interestingly enough, we wrote the Constitution for them under the guidance of General MacArthur and said, here it is, you sign it. I mean, this is your new Constitution. It was an American-written Constitution. And the language of that Constitution included the Second Bill of Rights, almost verbatim from the speech that FDR gave. Similarly, much of the language is included in the new West German Constitution that was passed. And the reason why this is interesting is that The Economist magazine every year ranks how democratic every nation in the world is. Now, The Economist magazine, which I'm a faithful reader of, has never been accused of being a left-wing publication. It is the publication of the financial industry in London, a business publication, but an excellent magazine. And every year they rank all the countries for how democratic they are. And it's interesting that the two countries that the last few years have been ranked as the most democratic countries in the world that have populations of 50 million or more, and there are some 30 countries that meet that 50 million or more criteria. The number one and two in recent years are always Germany and Japan, the countries with the constitutions that include FDR's Second Bill of Rights. It's a striking statement. When Martin Luther King in the 1960s introduced his freedom budget for how he would reform the United States, the language came largely from FDR's Second Bill of Rights. And then, interestingly enough, when Bernie Sanders was asked to define his vision of democratic socialism, and he gave a speech on it at Georgetown University in November of last year, if you had to happen to see the speech, you would know that he drew almost entirely on FDR's Second Bill of Rights as the foundation of his vision of what a democratic socialist society, the foundation of it would be, not unlike the social democratic societies of Scandinavia. So that's sort of, we think, a very strong place to start, a great rich tradition to look to understand where we might turn to come up with a democratic, equitable, humane solution and progressive solution to the great issues that are going to face us with technology and economy. The second period, and I'll go very briefly through this one, was the 1960s and early 1970s. This was the period, as I said before, when we had the great automation wave. It was a period of the great society. It's a period of immense optimism. And it was a period in which capitalism was hitting on all cylinders. Very low unemployment by the second half of the decade, in no small part thanks to the Vietnam War. But working class incomes by the early 1970s reached, I think, their historic peak in the United States for a male worker by 1972. It was a period that was probably the most democratic by Economist magazine type standards in American history. And it was a period in which the new technologies opened the vistas. I mean, one thing that's often been forgotten is that when President Lyndon Johnson introduced his idea of the Great Society in a speech at the University of Michigan at Ann Arbor in 1965. The whole speech was based on the idea that we were having an automation revolution that was going to greatly increase labor power and the ability of society to produce, and that scarcity would be something in the past that we could eliminate poverty. And LBJ's vision of the Great Society was one in which these technologies could allow us to really let every person have a life similar to what only people of great affluence were able to have in previous generations. It's a really romantic vision, but it's a powerful one. And we argue that there was a lot of people thinking creatively then. And it's a vision worth returning to and looking at again and thinking about, because I think there's a strong tendency to think of the worst possible outcome, dystopian view of technology. And that's not my perspective whatsoever. But I think the politics have to change in order to get the utopian developments. In the book, and this is my concluding point, in the book, we argued in the first draft of the book that we sent to our editor in 2015, I guess towards the end of 2015, we said that logically the period we're entering, what we should see in the United States, will be the emergence of two trends politically that have not been seen here for a long time, if ever. On the one hand, we should see the rise of something called democratic socialism, something like what FDR proposed, Martin Luther King in the 1960s, a return to a vision of a much more aggressively democratic society, committed to battling inequality, having the government provide services to those at the bottom end of the pecking order, and eliminating corruption. On the other hand, we should also see that there'll be the return of what we call the real F-bomb, the idea that democracy is a failure, it can't solve problems, problems are getting out of hand, and that we need instead to have a strong leader and the rise of right-wing populism or fascism. And I remember our editor wrote this back, it was not much less than a year ago, I mean it was 10 months ago, and she said to us, you can't use terms like socialism and fascism in a book for American readers. No one's going to buy that. Those terms mean nothing in the United States. And then about 3 or 4 months later, after Sanders and Donald Trump were very successful, she wrote us a note saying, I apologize. You guys might have been onto something. I confess it happened faster than we anticipated, but I think if you look closely, a lot of what we write about in the book, the sort of social currents underneath it, explain the unexpected and extraordinary rise of both these movements, although very different movements in almost every respect, nonetheless movements that grow out of the great insecurity, instability of our political economy at this time, about to be, if not already, aggravated by this technological revolution. Thank you very much.
Get the screen set up correctly. Dr. Atkinson, can you hear me?
Sure. Can everybody hear me okay?
Yes, you're coming in loud and clear. Point of fact, you're coming in much clearer.
I'm having a hard time hearing you.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
That's better.
Okay. Yeah, much better.
All right. Dr. Atkinson, I'm going to ask for your forbearance, and instead of giving us a speech about commenting on what Professor McChesney said, I would very much appreciate you just asking Professor McChesney leading questions or questions, and then at some point in the future, we would like to have you back to do your presentation on pretty much anything you would like to talk about, but I was kind of hoping it would be a counter to what Professor McChesney said. Is that okay?
Sure, that's fine. So I can't really ask him the professor questions about the democracy part. It's not really my specialty area, so I'll focus really on kind of the first half of what you said, which is really about automation and the labor market. I guess let me ask maybe three questions. One is, how do you explain the fact that post-recession U.S. labor productivity has been the lowest in recorded history since BLS and BEA started collecting these numbers in 1948? U.S. labor productivity post-recession is about half of what it was prior to that. That doesn't seem to me to be evidence of any kind of robot revolution. Secondly, how do you...
Dr. Atkinson, can we have Professor McChesney answer these questions one after another?
Absolutely, okay. Sure.
Professor McChesney, it's your turn.
Yeah, that's a great question. That's one I struggled with as we wrote this book and looked at. And there's a couple of reasons why I think that those you haven't seen this huge spike in productivity. Well, several reasons why, and here I'm doing a couple of these off the top of my head because it's been a while since I've thought about it. First of all, and not to be a butt covering exercise, but it's going to sound that way, our argument is what's coming, not what's existing. The existing situation we chronicle in the book, but our argument is if this is the existing situation, what happens when we introduce a wave of labor saving technologies, a radical wave as anticipated by Eric Schmidt and the like? So, secondly, I think there's a lot of debate about how accurate and effective productivity is for getting at that issue. And I was reading the literature on that, but it's not a consensus that that is the best way to understand necessarily whether technology is more productive. And this is a detailed argument. I can't get into the details of it, but when I was reading it, that was what I was seeing, a debate on that issue. And I'm not in a position to take either side, but I just noted that there was that debate.
Sure. Okay. So I guess my second question would be, you rightly point to, relatively weak labor market performance, particularly, I don't necessarily agree with poverty, but I do agree with wage growth, that wage growth has been less than optimal. Although there was a new San Francisco Federal Reserve Bank study just came out recently and showed that wage growth has been higher than what most economists have looked at. But I will grant you that point, that that's a problem. How could we possibly raise wages, which is a key factor that we have to do in our country, without raising productivity? In other words, it seems to me that you can have one of these, you can't have both of them. I'll let you answer. I think I know the answer, but it seems to me that without productivity, we can't raise wages.
Well, yes and no. What's interesting, Dr. Atkinson, is that if you go back 40 years and you look at the growth of productivity per worker in the U.S. economy since 1970 till 2015, say, you see a line that goes up really high, productivity per worker. And if you look at wages per worker, a line that goes at a slower rate. And between 1945 and 1970, the two lines were pretty much locked together. Productivity increased 3%, real wages increased 3%, and so on and so forth for over two decades. And that link was broken at some point in the 70s and grew wider by the late 70s and into the 80s to the point we are today. So it seems like part of the issue isn't simply raising productivity, because productivity is actually, in a historic sense, has been rising for four decades. But wages have not risen anywhere near as much. That's a political issue, changing it just so the larger claim to the productivity you've already increased goes to those who are the workers and not to the owners. And this goes to the issue of inequality. That can be addressed without further productivity increases.
Yeah, I'm sure there's a good economist joke I could tell about whether essentially two economists having two different views looking at the same data. You just would point out there are basically, as you noted earlier, there are conflicting studies on that question as well. I don't think anybody disagrees that the productivity labor gap that hasn't been one-to-one. No one disagrees with your point on that. I think the real question is how big is that gap? We would argue that gap is a little lower than some of that new, as I mentioned, that San Francisco Fed study. I guess my last question then, three, would be, why would you not think that the historical dynamic that has gone on really since the founding of our country has been as productivity grew, those gains were passed on to consumers or workers. In other words, wages went up and or prices went down. And they really didn't fundamentally go to profits. So if you look at profit rates today, they're actually about where they were in the 60s when, as you rightly note, that we were seeing 3% wage growth. So I think profits are kind of at the peak of where they could be from a kind of market perspective. They're not overly over, they're high, but they're not in the 30% range. They're in the like 13% range. So my question then would be, why would we not expect to see the historical pattern happen that productivity gains get passed on either to workers or to consumers, who then historically have used those gains to go out and buy new things? So as the price of restaurants go down, you eat out more and have lunch in Boulder. As the price of clothing goes down, people buy a lot more clothes than they did 30 years ago. As the price of travel goes down, people travel more. Why wouldn't we see that just going on into the future and therefore not having structural high levels of unemployment? In other words, that supply would then create demand.
Yeah, well, I think it's empirically we haven't seen that for a while, if we ever have. I don't accept necessarily the premise that that goes back to 1776. They had phenomenal productivity increases in the southern economy between 1830 and 1860. Maybe they got passed along to consumers. They certainly, in Europe or someplace like that, they certainly did get passed along to the employees of the firms in the South that were producing the wealth of the southern Mississippi basin. As for the idea that they don't go to profits, but instead they go to workers or consumers, they go to workers or consumers not because businesses, hey, we're really nice guys, we're just going to pay workers part of it, and we're going to get lower prices for other part. They do it, as the economists know, for market reasons or political reasons. If workers have leverage with unions or some other market pressure, they have gets higher wages. But if they don't have unions or they don't have market pressure, they're certainly not going to get paid anymore, even if they're producing more. There's no law that these businesses will give them more. Likewise, if consumers don't have that much leverage, companies are certainly not going to turn over potential profits just because they're nice guys or dummies. I wouldn't invest in a company that has turned over some of its, lowered its prices just for the heck of it, if it didn't have to, and pass along gains. And I think here we get to the point that our U.S. economy today has a degree of economic concentration that is extraordinarily high. I won't use the term unprecedented, because I can't say, you can't find some period in which it was less, more unequal, or didn't have greater concentration. But it is now, you know, we have tremendous concentration by most of the indicators I've seen relative historically. And one of the reasons firms like to operate in semi-monopolistic and oligopolistic industries is that you have more control of your price, of your product. You don't have to lower it. You have less competitive pressure. And if you have less labor unions and there's a high unemployment rate, you certainly don't have any pressure on wages, much less pressure to share the bounty with wages. I mean, we've seen that with wages for the last three decades. Companies doing extraordinarily well, yet still nonetheless moving factories to even lower wage places when those were alternatives. And not saying, gee, we're making so much money, we're going to raise the wages here in Michigan or Indiana or Ohio or Wisconsin. We're doing much better. Instead, well, we're doing better, but heck, we can even do better than that. If we move the jobs to Mexico or China or Haiti or someplace like that, or just to a southern state as a way station without labor unions. So I think there are complex political issues there, but I think if you get to the lack of labor unions and the lack of, and the growth of the dominance of monopoly, which then translates into control over the governing system so that the government works in the interest of those at the top much more so than having much of an interest of those not at the top.
So I could respond, because I don't necessarily agree with the framing there or the data, but I will stop there unless you want me to keep going. So.
I would like you to respond to that, Dr. Atkinson, and then I'm going to ask the people here for questions. I have a whole slew of them. So go ahead, Dr. Atkinson.
Sure. So I guess my response would be that there's a term in economics called the lump of labor fallacy, and the notion is that, you know, you have a job, and once it's eliminated, that job is gone, and that person gets on, is permanently unemployed. Yeah, historically, absent the periods when we've been in recessions, that just simply has not been the U.S. experience. There's a very strong correlation between total number of jobs and total number of workers, the adult population who are in the labor force. Very strong correlation. And I just simply don't see that would be broken. First of all, I'll just say two things there. One, as I said before, I just simply refuse to believe that profit rates would go above 15%. They've never been above 15% historically, because when profits are high, you get entry. You get firms coming into a market saying, this is a high profit industry, I want to come in, or you get disrupted. So not all of the gains can go to profits, because then you're talking 20, 30, 40% corporate profits, which never has the U.S. seen. But even that, which let's say it's not going to happen, but even that, let's just say it happened. What do companies do with high profits? They do one of two things. They either reinvest them in the company, which creates jobs. I think you would acknowledge that. They buy a new machine, or they build a new plant or whatever, and that would create jobs under any economic model. Or secondly, they spend it. They give it to shareholders. And what do the shareholders do? They spend it. They buy a new house. They send their kids to college. So you know, my first point is, I don't buy that it goes all to profits. But even if it were to go all to profits, that money goes back into the economy, which creates demand for new workers.
Okay. I'm going to ask a questioner. Can you hear
me clearly?
Yeah, I hear you fine, thanks.
Great. I'm going to make a couple of questions, and then I'm going to ask people here to address questions to Professor McChesney rather than to Dr. Atkinson, and then Dr. Atkinson can respond to what Professor McChesney responds with. So I'd like Professor McChesney to and Robert, Dr. Atkinson to respond to his response to me. We were talking about lack of productivity wage gains, even though the productivity has gone up. What is the possibility that the reason for that was precisely that the Great Society broke the relationship between productivity and getting money, you know, getting money from the government, basically? I believe that one of our participants here, a man by the name of, has pointed out that we have spent more. We spent something like $20,000, $30,000 a year on the war on poverty, and we could have brought all of those people into the middle class if we had simply given them the money that had been basically, from our perspective, wasted. So, Professor McChesney, would you respond to my question?
Yeah, there can be lots of criticism of the Great Society and those social programs associated with it. I've never heard that it was a cause of the split in productivity and wages in the 70s. That's a new theory. So I've never really thought about that. I'm having trouble wrapping around the connection there, where I can see how the two are directly connected. So I'm at a hard press to give an intelligent rebuttal to the point. I'll let Dr. Atkinson deal with that one if he wants to.
I guess I'd say the same argument. I don't know. I've not heard that argument about the delinking. You could perhaps make that argument about labor force participation rates. I'll give you an example. There's been a very big spike in the number of people who are on SSI disability from the Social Security Administration. These are pre-retiree people who could work in theory but are disabled. When they changed the SSI disability laws in, I forget the year, to be a lot more accommodating, the number of people being on disability just dramatically increased. Now, some people argue they're honestly disabled. Other people will argue they're perhaps could be working but are getting free money and therefore don't have to work. So I think it's a better, or maybe a little bit more accurate argument to talk about labor force participation rates than to say productivity. But again, I hadn't looked at that either.
Yeah, no, on that issue that you raised, Dr. Atkinson, that's what I was, when you talked about the lump of labor notion, which I think is an accurate one, one of the issues that about the current economy that we talk about in our book is the decline in labor rate participation in the last 15 years. And I don't have the data right in front of me. I could look it up. But, you know, we have a chart in the book actually says how many jobs would have to be people would have to return to, you know, how many people had to leave the labor force to keep the unemployment rate we've lost over 10 million jobs, basically, that we had in 2001 that haven't come back. People have left the labor force. And as Tyler Cowen, the economist, puts it, and I might say libertarian conservative economist puts it, the loss of jobs in the economy is largely among white men 25 to 54, the new group. There are other people who've left it before, but who aren't participating. And as he puts it, these aren't wealthy playboys who've left the labor market. These are people who are working class people for the most part. And that's one of the issues that, you know, is a new development, relatively speaking, and certainly in my lifetime in our economy.
Is there anybody here who has a question? So we'll start with Blake. And please yell.
You're inviting me. Never mind. Can you hear me, sir? Professor.
Barely. Maybe if you move closer to the mic, or maybe someone can repeat the question so Dr. Atkinson and I can hear it.
I'll come closer to the microphone. Can you hear me better now? Are you able to hear me better now, sir?
Very perfect.
Excellent. So my my major in college was economics, and when I studied the components of GNP back at that time, since post-World War to late 60s, which is when I was in school, I noticed a difference in the percentage of sole proprietors and corporations as components of the GNP. And I can only assume that that has escalated since then. What I saw from the 50s to the 60s, the percentage of small businesses and sole proprietors shrunk decisively and corporations expanded geometrically. Would you care to comment?
I'm not exactly familiar with that, so I can't really comment intelligently. But I can say that, we have a chart on this in the book, and we've done some work on this. We look at the percentage of GDP accounted for by the 400 largest firms in the economy and how that's changed over time. And it has grown appreciably in the last 40 years or 50 years, sharply. That's just one way to measure what you're sort of getting at. So that's all I can say.
Quentin, do you have a question? Yeah. If you do, please come around.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can.
Okay. My question is in respect to the employment rate. And I was wondering what linkage there might be made between agricultural era and the Industrial Revolution era that followed. What kind of a correlation could be made between the employment rates with these two respective periods? Because that could be a parallel to, see if there's a correlation between automation and employment rate, just based on historical evidence from the past.
Not sure I follow exactly what you're getting at, Blake.
Well, during, for example, in the United States, I think about 80% of the U.S. population was just devoted to growing food, mm-hmm. and they couldn't produce any other consumer items, mostly. So what was the unemployment rate then when the automation was very low to now that we, from the Industrial Revolution that followed, did that lower or increase the employment rate?
That's a really interesting question. Unfortunately, the situation we're in is one where we don't really have one Industrial Revolution. We talk about the United States. It was a long process in different ways. There was an Industrial Revolution in the Northeast and Mid-Atlantic states prior to the Civil War. There's the Great Industrial Revolution of the second half of the 19th century. We've been going through them ongoing. And the number of agricultural workers has declined radically from being 80% or more to what is it today, 2 or 3% of the popular workforce, if that. So I'm not sure I can. I do think what you're getting at, which is important, is that when you move to a largely industrial capitalist economy, the notion of unemployment as being a fixed and clear part of the economic system, always existing and being an issue, moves front and center in a way that it wasn't under economies that were pre-industrial capitalists. I mean, not that it wasn't important there, but those are a different set of issues there compared to a modern capitalist economy where private investment drives much of employment. I don't know if that's a very good answer, but that's the best I can do. I'll let Dr. Atkinson chime in if he wants to.
Yeah, so I think that to me, is a really good point, because if you think about what happened after the agricultural revolution, when we had 60% of the people who are farmers, and now it's about 2.5%, which is also, by the way, why you're eating in a restaurant today, because food is so cheap because of high productivity. We don't have 50 or 60% unemployment. There were certainly transition problems, no question about that. Certain groups of individuals had a hard time making a transition. But overall, in the moderate term, as a society, you know, we don't have a lot of people making food. We have fewer people manufacturing. But human needs, to me, are close to infinite. I bet if you ask yourselves or your kids if you would enjoy having a salary or income that's double, if you could figure out things to spend on it, I think you probably would find them quite easily. I know I would like a double salary because my son's going to University of Colorado Boulder, and he tells me how expensive it is to pay his rent every month. So I think human needs are infinite, and we should never have to worry about that. As we get richer, there'll be lots and lots of things we want to spend our money on, and that'll create jobs.
Anybody else want to talk? Because I have Jana, please come up here. As they say in Price is Right, come on up. Come on down. I'm sorry.
Hello.
We're libertarians. Come on up.
Oh, yeah. Let's see if I can summarize here. I wanted to ask Dr. Chesney.
McChesney,
yeah, a couple of questions. I'm seeing the crisis we have more as a crisis of freedom. I grew up in communism, and I came here to be free, and I didn't expect the government to provide everything. And you mentioned something about a democratic society and FDR. I did read about that. I mean, I talked to people about that. I'm wondering if you could specify what exactly you understand by democracy. To me, democracy is the system of our Constitution and what the Founding Fathers set up so we can have the right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. Because I don't see a guarantee of housing and healthcare being compatible with freedom. So if you could define democracy. The other thing is, I'm wondering what you understand by capitalism. In my mind, capitalism is a society where we have the right to a free market economy if we want it. Obviously, we can force people to open businesses and hire people, as long as the government doesn't have too many regulations to prevent that. So I'm wondering what you understand by capitalism, and because you're saying that it doesn't satisfy what we need to do today to have a better society, I guess.
Can we?
Yeah, thank you.
You asked two questions in there, and so one at a time, Professor McChesney, if you wouldn't mind.
Well, those are fantastic questions, and the good news is that actually in the book we go exactly through those precise questions in some detail, and so I don't know if I can do them justice in short, pithy answers. The crisis of freedom you talk about, I agree completely, and I think sometimes in the United States especially, there is a bogus duality made between government power and private power. The government's this sort of out there, the federal government in particular, threatening our freedoms, and then private power doesn't really have any role in that, and it's sort of a different thing altogether. I'm not sure that accurately reflects how power works in our society or the role of the government. I think the problem we have in our society is too much that the government is captive to private power, especially large private power, and that it works in cahoots with it, and that is very dangerous to our freedom. And I think that one need only look at the prevalence of spying by the NSA on the American people, on all of us, on this conversation for all we know. That is a, you know, I've chronicled this in other writings I've done. These are the government and private interests work hand in hand in these processes. They are not that, they have some debates on some things, but it's generally a very harmonious relationship between the largest companies and the federal government of the United States. And that does hurt our freedom. I agree. That's where the separation is just a joke of powers. And I think most of the political science research on how governing decisions are made in the United States have reached that conclusion that if you want to understand what decisions are made by the federal government, almost all of them, you just have to look as far as who has economic power, and that's going to shape what that decision will be. And the actual regular people who are not wealthy have virtually no influence whatsoever on government decisions. That's the result of most political science studies that I've seen and that we note in our work. So there is a crisis of freedom, but it's not a crisis that the private sector is being, the largest corporations, the Microsofts and the industrial firms and the banks are being harassed by sort of an out-of-control government. It's where they're working together hand-in-hand to most of their benefits. But the driving force is where the money is. That's where the money is in a capitalist. That's where the power always is in a capitalist society. What do I mean by a capitalist society? The definition I use is an economy that is driven by private investment, the pursuit of profit. You have that, you have capitalism. You don't have that, you don't have capitalism. Everything flows from that. And we are a capitalist economy. Now, that, if you put it that way, there are lots of different types of capitalism. Norway is a capitalist society. You can start a business in Norway. You can become fabulously rich in Norway. But in Norway, they have all those things FDR talked about in 1944 and more. They've got, you know, you get a year off from work if you have a child. You're paid a government subsidy for every child to have a healthy baby. But they're still, it's a private economy. It's people investing and making money. It's capitalism. It's not a socialist economy. It's not Bulgaria in 1968. Nothing like that whatsoever. So you can have a profit-driven economy and have huge variances in what type of profit-driven economy, what role profits play, and how much the profit-driven interests get to control the government itself. And those are the big fights that we go through. In this country, that fight was lost in the last 40 years. The general public now is strictly a spectator to an idiotic charade put on by the news media and the Washington insiders about politics, but really nothing changes in terms of the actual exercise of power. Regardless of who wins, I think it's pretty much an inside game. And then finally, the most important question you ask is, didn't the founding, the framers of this country, those who wrote the Constitution in 1787, 1788, didn't they outline that, you know, this is going to be a capitalist country? That's the way it's got to be, and that ends it for all time. That's the essence of freedom. And that's simply not true. That is a really great question, and it's one I studied a lot because I think it's really interesting. We write about it at some length in the book, The Formation of the Constitution. And I think if you study that period, you find out that there was a tremendous struggle going on, creation of this country, from the Declaration of Independence in 1776 through the 1790s over what exactly this country would be. That the idea that the Constitution was a mandate for what we call capitalism today, what I just described, is preposterous. You know how many banks there were in the United States in 1789? Banks? There was one bank in the country. Alexander Hamilton's Bank of the United States. We were that was like Norway was when Norway was colonized by the Danes and the Swedes in the 19th century. I mean, we did not, we were almost overwhelmingly agricultural country. Slavery was our, you know, a dominant part of our economy. It was a very different world. And so there were phenomenal debates that went on in that period about what type of democracy should have. And it was all about how much power should be given to those who weren't owners. And the people who convened in Philadelphia were very reluctant to share power with those without property. They didn't approve of universal suffrage. They thought that they were signed off on slavery. Even people like John Adams, who opposed it, signed off on it as a condition of keeping the colonies together. And one of the questions you might want to consider is, why is it that all the southern states supported a rebellion from England on behalf of democracy? Why would they do that? Against capitalism, when Britain was by far the most advanced capitalist country in the world in the 1770s and 1780s, no one else was close. Well, the historical evidence has now come in. We sort of suspected, but very few Americans ever asked that question. Why would the South, why would Virginia, South Carolina, North Carolina, why would they sign up for a revolution against Britain to be in an all men are created equal world when their whole economy is based on all men not being created equal? And the reason is that in 1772, the British courts determined that slavery was no longer covered by common law, could not be protected. And that was the beginning of the end for slavery in Britain and the beginning of the end for the slave trade. And the Brits, in fact, were mobilizing slaves to help them fight the revolution. because they understood slavery is actually one of the reasons southern states went to protect slavery. It's one of the reasons they wanted to revolt from Britain. So we have a much more complex history. It's worth studying. It's a great history, but it's complex, and it's hardly an endorsement of American capitalism circa 2016.
Dr. Atkinson, care to respond?
Well, I think this is oversimplification. I think if you want to say, you know, that the entire thing is rigged by elites, then how do we explain Donald Trump? I mean, that's, to me, case in point. If the elites were really running things, Trump wouldn't have won a single election. But secondly, and this is a point that Dr. McChesney is deeply, deeply involved in, because he and his one organization he helped found was the leader of it, and that's the issue of what's called net neutrality. For those of you who don't know, this is about a broadband internet and what broadband internet service providers can do or cannot do. And I won't go into all the details, but we think it's a bad decision because it basically means that the Skype call we're having today can't be prioritized on the ISP. So you really want this call to be very, very good, and you want it to have advantage so right now there are all these bits flowing across some wire between us and all three of us, and there are email bits going across as well. And what you really want is the email bits to arrive a second or two later, but not have disruption with our video bits, because it's two different kinds of things going on one wire. What hardcore net neutrality would do would make that illegal. And that's really what just happened. And I think it's a very bad idea, but we're not going to have a debate about that. My only point about that is that only happened, that did not happen because industry wanted it. There were a few firms that wanted it. That happened largely because of a grassroots movement all around the country, orchestrated and supported by groups like Public Knowledge and Free Press and a lot of other sort of civic action groups who said this is important to us. That wasn't a Washington insider thing. That was a grassroots effort. So I wouldn't underestimate that sort of grassroots movements have no ability to do things. I think they were very successful in this case of getting something that wouldn't have happened otherwise.
Dr. Atkinson, I don't know your background or background, but who do you work for?
I run a think tank called Information Technology and Innovation Foundation.
Do you receive any money whatsoever from companies like AT&T, Comcast, any of those companies?
So this is where...
I'm just curious. It's a yes-no question. It's not a...
Okay, I'm not going to answer it unless you let me answer.
Well, I mean...
The full answer.
Well, start with yes-no and then give your answer. Then you can give your explanation, but I don't want
to... I'm not going to answer unless you let me answer.
Okay, so lawyer bullshit coming up, everyone. Just see, you're aware of this?
So this is just the point I'm going to make, is whenever you get in a debate with people on this, particularly on this issue, the only answer they can have is not a technical or sort of policy question, what's right. They immediately bring out an ad hominem attack. How much money does Free Press get from Soros? And if you said to Soros, by the way, we're not going to do that, how much money would your organization, Free Press, get denied? And by the way, so you want to argue with us about our positions on net neutrality? And by the way...
Hey, guys, you brought me in to do this talk, right? And what's this guy? Is this guy some ringer for AT&T you brought in here? It's going to raise an issue that's not even in our book. What, you guys want this meeting? Is this what you want for today? You're going to bring someone in to hassle him as a ringer when he gives his talk?
I would like...
the only one who gets the ringer brought in who raises this crap and paid off by AT&T and won't even admit it.
Dr. Atkinson, Professor McChesney actually has made a point, so I'm going to ask that we defer this for future discussion, where this becomes a debate rather than a presentation with response. So I'm going to ask a very innocuous question. Professor McChesney, how much more time do you have?
Very little.
Okay. And Professor and Dr. Atkinson, how much more time do you have?
I'll tell you, the amount of time I've left is the amount of time you can have a ringer come in on Dr. Atkinson's talk and sort of raise issues like, just out of the blue for someone that I'm paid off for and they're paid off for to harass them on. Or does he get a free ride? When do you pick when you bring the ringer in to raise issues that their benefactors want raised?
What I would like to do is have Dr. Atkinson and you, Professor McChesney, come back for a discussion on this very issue, so there is not an issue of ringers involved. If you know, if I would like to have this be a very civil conversation. Point of fact, I'm very proud of the people here who are libertarians, and they have been extremely polite, and I would like to have that that continue. So that's why I'm asking Dr. Atkinson to refrain from an ad hominem attack, and I'm going to ask you, Professor McChesney, to do the same. I can
just make one clear point. I did not engage in an ad hominem attack. I did after Robert did. But the point that I raised that was not to raise the issue of net neutrality, Robert. I don't have any desire to debate that with you. None. My only point was to raise a political point where you said that the sort of masses, the sort of average person, has no say in Washington. Are you saying that your movement and your group didn't have a success and it wasn't due to a grassroots effort? That's my only point. I'm not arguing whether it's right or wrong. I don't care about that right now. I think it's wrong. It wasn't my point. I made that clear. My only point was a political point, to say that grassroots movements still can have an effect on Washington politics. That's the only point I was making.
Okay, fair enough. And I would just say I wish that were the case, but unfortunately, the victory in net neutrality was very much, except for the reason why I asked the benefactors question, the only industry that really wants to get rid of net neutrality, that puts a lot of money behind it, are the ISPs. They want to privatize the internet, and I don't want to get into that issue. But, you know, you don't have any random business saying, gee whiz, we want to, like, get rid of net neutrality because it really hurts our business. Most of the business community likes net neutrality because they don't want to give the power to AT&T, Verizon, Comcast to privatize the internet and cherry pick who can use the internet and who can't. They don't think they should have monopoly power over the broadband pipeline. And I don't want to get into that issue. But so I'd say significant businesses made it clear this isn't a fight. They're not going to go down fighting for AT&T and Verizon's right to make more money, oftentimes at their expense, charging them more because they have the power to do so.
I would like to ask both of you to let's not talk about net neutrality. I do want to continue on the issue of how computers, who have gotten far more powerful and will be getting far more powerful, will cause a structural change in our society, such that we will, such that the political order requires a redistributive effort. Am I phrasing what your position is, Professor McChesney?
I'm not sure if I follow you. Maybe you could repeat it.
What I'm saying is
the Cambrian Revolution,
where the instigator of the Cambrian Revolution is the fact that the computers have become so much smarter, just like the DNA back then became so much more capable of creating complex structure. I mean, I'm taking your position and I'm trying to rephrase it. I hope I'm doing it well.
Well, you might be. Maybe it's just I'm a little slow. I'm trying. I'm not sure.
Being slow is not what you are, Professor McChesney. I'm going to stop. Valerie, and please come up here. Come on down or up as you see fit. So we're going to change. We're going to take a question from the audience. First to Professor McChesney, and then for a response from Dr. Atkinson.
Hi, Dr. Professor McChesney. My name's Sona Turley, and I wanted a couple of points of clarification. I was trying very hard to listen to you attentively, and please correct me if I've misperceived your basic premise. The first thing that I took issue with and didn't completely understand was what I believe to be your assertion that with increased robotics, we will develop the capacity to produce more than can be consumed. Is that a correct interpretation of your position?
Well, it's sort of really not, it's not the way I would frame it. It would be able to produce more with less human labor.
And I understood that.
Whether that's more than we need depends how much you want to produce.
That's
what
struck
me. At some point, we'll be able to produce a lot more, a sufficient amount for human existence with less human labor than is currently necessary.
And I understood that to be your initial premise, but then you actually did succinctly say the latter, that we will have the ability to produce more than can be consumed, and I thought the two were mutually
I mean, we'll have that ability. We have that ability now, I guess. If someone put a gun at everyone's head, factory owner's head, or business, and you have to produce maximum output, we could produce more than we could possibly consume, but the businesses would go out of business because they couldn't sell their product.
And because, as the point was made earlier by someone here, part of investing profits is to re-energize and improvise within an industry or technology, so we don't always take 100% of our profit because it is in direct contradiction to business growth. That being said, my second question is...
Dr. Atkinson respond to... Okay. Please respond if you wish, Dr. Atkinson.
Yeah, 2 points. One is, again, human needs are infinite. I mean, Professor McChesney said that we're going to produce what is sufficient. Who are you to say what's sufficient? What is sufficient is what people decide is sufficient for them. And I can tell you most Americans, given that...
I wasn't saying I was going to decide, Dr. Atkinson.
You said there's a term, something is sufficient, and I don't think anyone can define that except people, except consumers. And there's no evidence that anybody, given that the median income today is about $52,000 per household, you know, it could be $500,000 per household and we wouldn't run out of things to spend money on. We just simply were not going to do that. You know, when Keynes wrote his famous article in the Saturday Evening Post, Letters to Our Grandchildren, he didn't envision things like having high HD screens, high definition screens. He didn't envision most people going to a foreign country at least once in their life on vacation. You know, he couldn't envision these new needs and these new desires that we have. And that's really what's going to continue to happen. That's what capitalist evolution has always done. It's created things that people want. And then the second point, that somehow we can produce more, that companies are inherently holding back their productivity because they don't want to disrupt their competitors. I mean, there's simply no evidence of that. That if you think about company productivity, the main thing companies want to do is boost their productivity so they can get a competitive advantage over their competitors and undersell them. There's no conspiracy going on to limit output.
Said there was a conspiracy. What are you talking about? What
you said. I'll tell you exactly. You said, quote, companies can produce more than we can possibly consume, but they don't do that because they don't want to put themselves...
Well, that's a different thing from what you're talking about. That means, for example, Heinz ketchup. If they put all their factories in the world working max out to produce as much ketchup as they wanted, they could produce a lot more ketchup than they currently do. But they don't, because if they do that, they'd have to lower the price dramatically. That was simply the point I was making. It wasn't anything about what you were rambling on about.
Can I please ask that the insults be...
I really apologize. My time has come to an end. It's 10 of, and I've got my daughter downstairs wanting my attention. I really have a great time. Thank you all very much.
Dr. Atkinson, do you wish to remain or...
I can stay on. I've got till 4 o'clock if that's useful to you. It's up to you.
4 o'clock, where is he? East Coast?
East Coast,
4 o'clock East Coast, yeah. 2 o'clock your time, I guess.
It's 2 o'clock right now. It's 10 minutes from now. It's 4 o'clock East Coast.
Yeah.
So we've got 10 more minutes?
I have to leave at 4, but yeah, so if that's useful to you, I'm happy to stay for 10
okay,
more.
Okay, great. First of all, I want to express both to you and to Professor McChesney, thank you so much for giving us your time. It's been wonderful. I would very much... love it if you came back to talk about the five myths of AI that touches on and sort of subverts much of what Professor McChesney was talking about, which is why I'd like you to come back. I will invite him to respond to you, and you would be our primary speaker if you wouldn't mind doing that sometime in the future.
Sure, he can be the ringer.
He can be the ringer, yes. I'm going to... anybody else have a question? Because
does the doctor have a book?
Dr. Atkinson, do you have a book that you wish to promote?
Well, our last book was a book called Innovation Economics, and it was about sort of how economies are being transformed by innovation and how companies are being transformed by innovation and why innovation is a good thing and why we shouldn't give in to sort of Luddite fears about more of it, that, you know, innovation is really kind of the central driver of human progress and freedom, and that's what we need more of.
I'm going to Quentin, let me finish up because he's got 10 minutes here.
Right.
And I'm just going to take privilege here. I want to return for a moment to the comment I made about linkage of the Great Society and the reduction in productivity. I ask you to just think about the following. If we have a society in which 100 people work, and then all of a sudden the government, whatever that is, mandates that 50 of those people no longer work, either by force or by incentive, you can get an increase in productivity per worker, and yet the entire society's productivity has gone down. Do you see that?
You mean if they're not working?
Clearly, if they're not working, they're not producing. Therefore, if you average across all potential workers rather than all workers, then the societal efficiency or the societal productivity, if each worker who's working, worker who is working, his productivity goes up by 25%, but 50% of the people are not working, society's overall productivity goes down. That's what I was saying. If you incentivize people not to work, whether it's by Social Security or whatever, you're going to see over the entire society a reduction in productivity. You can respond to that if you'd like, but I was kind of hoping Professor McChesney would respond to that rather than you. Go ahead.
I think just as a technical term, there's a difference between productivity and output, and what you're really referring to is output would decline. Technically, productivity would increase, but output declines because you have fewer workers. So productivity is output per hour. I think where you see that, frankly, I think you're right in general. Where you see that, for example, is in Europe, where they pay people to retire early. A lot more people retire at 55 or 60 in Europe. They pay people for very long periods of time to be unemployed, sometimes three years. They give them a lot of money while they're unemployed, so they have very little incentive to go back to work. And that just means that there are just going to be a lot more people who could be working who are out of the labor market, and that lowers GDP.
Productivity per worker increases, overall society productivity, if you will, decreases.
Sure.
So that's what I meant. Quentin, ask your question, and I will.
It's actually a question about what McChesney comment. He was associating banks with capitalism, and he also he stated in regards to the agricultural society, pre-industrial, that was not capitalism, or implied that it was less capitalism. Would that fall? I don't really agree with that. That just because people are using land and growing food, that means that they're less capitalistic than we are today.
It was certainly a market where you had producers who used their own capital or other people's capital and took risks with it. The formal definition that some people use of capitalism is essentially, stock, public stock companies where people take money, give it to somebody else or an organization and to use it. But certainly farming is a market-based economy. People took risks, so they used capital. So, yeah, it's not as if somehow that one is capitalism and one is not. I agree with that.
Anybody else? Because I have two more comments. Okay, then I will make the two comments. First is I completely agree with you I agree with you about disagreeing with Professor McChesney about the use of profits by corporations. I was going to make the point that one of the things that companies do when they to lower price to maximize profit is to gain market share. So it's a profit maximization issue. Everybody reasonably attempts to increase profits, so that's why the prices may come down. So that's one point. I believe you made the same point with slightly different words. And last, I'm going to finish this up with something of a little bit of humor. Professor McChesney at one point made the Freudian slip by calling somebody, some mythical person, Bernie Trump, And as a group of libertarians here, that carried a lot of weight. And so, Dr. Atkinson, I want to say thank you for giving us just about 2 hours of your time. I really, really appreciate it. You were wonderful. I do hope that you'll come back again, with or without Professor McChesney, to impart some of your great wisdom on us.
Absolutely. Let me know. Happy to do it.
Thank you so much. Take care again.
All right. Take care. Enjoy the rest of the day.
I look forward to reading your book.
One of our whoops. All right. Jerry, I'm going to give...
Can we have kind of a private discussion amongst us?
Oh, absolutely. I've turned off the recording. I've turned off the video recording, but we are still recording audio.
I'd like to comment on your agricultural thing. I think the agricultural movement was, in the early days and even now, migrant workers. So it did not employ citizens of the country, but it employed people from outside our country to gain work. And to make money and send it to their homeland.
Yeah, that's the modern man. Was that true back in the early days, pre-industrial?
I don't think they had the migration ability. My mother was a migrant worker, came from Germany.
Beet field
workers in Longmont, Loveland area. And they didn't send any money home. They actually spent the money here, eventually became United States citizens.
Yeah, and became capitalists.
Right. So in that sense, those people were brought over to help the economy. They were actually brought over as farmers to help existing farmers make a profit and do business. So,
they built the railroad. You know, they brought the Asians over to help build the transcontinental railroad. So they were like more like employees rather than capitalists. They didn't aspire,
rather than illegals. Right.
I have Blake and then Heidi.
I just want to make a quick comment of what you guys are talking about. On my father's birth certificate, he's born in 1920, on his birth certificate, his father's occupation, on the birth certificate back then, they said usual occupation. So there's no such thing, this is pre-Depression, there was no such thing as you have a job and you're counted as unemployed. Farmers back then hired their kids, so there's no way to really compare pre-1930s unemployment to post-1930s unemployment.
We just turn off the mic.
That's the only point
I want to make.
Heidi. You can really tell somebody's political stripes by how they feel about FDR. And, you know, progressives like McChesney, they just love him and his second Bill of Rights. And look, he was talking about how in 1944, FDR said, we have to make sure fascism doesn't take root here. What a joke. I mean, you know that famous book by Wolfgang Schimmelwitz, Three New Deals? He basically wrote about all the parallels between what FDR was doing here, what Hitler was doing in Germany, and what Mussolini was doing in Italy. I mean, it was all fascism, corporatism, big, big, big government, huge public works projects, which were boondoggles. The word boondoggle took root during FDR's era, right? And the idea that he's preaching against fascism, saying we can't let it take root here, when a lot of libertarians consider him our
enemy,
our little fascist. I mean, if fascism is the merger of state and corporate power, he was really good at that. Propaganda campaigns with the Blue Eagle, the whole nine yards, you know, persecuting a tailor for not charging enough, you know?
Is there anybody... Is there anybody here? I'm sorry, is there a question?
I just wanted to comment on the capitalism and agricultural kind of thing, just a little bit. I've been doing some research about different things, and what I found out, one thing, we have very liberal ideology being taught in universities, which is mostly funded by taxpayers' money. In addition, the loans and all that, turns out it's much less than half that most people don't realize.
Could you say that again, Jana? I can barely understand you.
I'm talking about the ideology. There's one type of ideology that really encourages socialist-type thinking in our universities and colleges through social sciences, behavioral sciences, and things like that, and I've been doing some research lately on that. I saw a movie, I think there was a connection, and it's important to try to define the terms, and that's why I asked the question what Dr. Chesney understands by democracy and capitalism, because I saw a movie a couple of months ago called Awakenings, I think. It's by Daryl Hannah on sustainability and all that, and they had farms in India and Africa, and they were talking how this is also wonderful. They were not calling me capitalist, and when I saw that, I said, oh, capitalist. Then later on in the same movie, they showed how big industry destroys the environment in some junkyards here in New York and Brooklyn and other places, and they said, oh, here are the what happens when capitalism rules, and this is capitalism, all that, you know, and I think, okay, that's capitalism too. I mean, it doesn't mean it has, you know,
two forms
fix the garbage part. But the point, let's see, I was trying to make a point here, that I'm going to talk about Agenda 21 and what implications, what I've seen in this country that's actually being implemented, and what I'm seeing is...
Jana, could we not talk about that today? Because you're going to be having a whole session on that.
I know, but I want you to make a connection between terms, like what capitalism means, because...
With land ownership, that would be capitalism.
Well, just because you own a small farm doesn't necessarily mean you have strong property rights. And that's why I was getting to Agenda 21. We are being given more of a leash, so to speak. But strong property rights are taken away. And this is a very important thing to understand when you see what's happening in the world, including in this
country. Again, let's not talk about Agenda 21 today. I will say that, Jana, be prepared for pushback from some people who believe that Agenda 21... Okay, I just want to let you know about that.
I don't know about Agenda 21.
You know nothing about
it? No, then you need to come. Then you need to come.
Then you need to come to the session.
Oh, okay.
Okay. We now have at least two people who believe in Agenda 21. I'm going to remain neutral on that issue. Okay, I intend to be convinced. Okay, are we done? Should I turn off the... no, Brian, you're the last speaker.
So in terms of the disconnect between productivity and wages, that was an issue that I figured some of them focus on. AI did a good job of debunking that and showing that productivity and wages have gone up. But I think part of it is things like they ignore on the total compensation, things like health benefits and things like that. That's part of the disconnect. And then the other issue is that obviously if productivity is going up and it's not going into wages, then as you say, if profit isn't going up, then it has to go someplace, so it's lowered prices or sort of...
Which is a form of... Yeah.
The
point of fact, Brian, what I'd like to do is I'd like to spend an entire lunch on that topic because I think it's an important one. The corrosive effects of government basically taking income from producers and redistributing it to
non-producers.
So, and what are all the implications of that?
Yeah, part of the gap I was going to get to is essentially the fact that as regulatory costs have gone up, then that's an extra piece of the pie that's gone up, which is where the gap
is. Let's do that on some session.